71-year old male came with chief complaint of gross hematuria for 2 days. Hematuria is painless, total, associated clots with no any history of retention of urine. Patient had a similar episode of hematuria 6 months back, which resolved spontaneously, and patient didn't seek any treatment for that. Patient also had irritative looks in the form of frequency, daytime 10 times and night also 10. There was urgency and nocturia. There is no history of any incontinence, no history of obstructive urinary tract symptoms, no history of any recurrent stone passes, lithuria, and there is no history of prior any peripheral instrumentation.
Shubham, this irritative symptoms are before hematuria or after hematuria?
Actually, the patient said that the irritative symptoms are on and off, and it is almost 2 to 3 months when he is noticing more.
This why did you write that clots is not associated with image retention of urine?
Retention of urine is separate, sir.
No, it is with no history of retention. It's something, yes. See, if you I would appreciate it if you have written clots, whether it was amorphous, whether it was a thread or tubular type or something like that, rather than saying retention of urine. Retention of urine, the patient, you don't have to ask. You will definitely say, just like hematuria, the retention is a big problem. The patient will immediately rush to the hospital and
yes,
all
yes,
those things.
Yes. Yes.
So I would ask you another way. This lower tract symptoms, what you call storage symptoms, is it because of the hematuria or something else may be the contributing factors?
It could be due to the clots presenting in the bladder may cause this irritating symptoms, sir. And also there could be other any mass lesion which could lead to this irritating symptoms, sir.
Sir, we can hear properly, sir. Prama said, Shubham, are you able to hear clearly? Or
yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, Dr. Mohan mentioned that he couldn't hear. So maybe problem at your end because it's very clear here.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, coming back, see, the one is the, if you are thinking, what are you thinking of at this point in time?
At this point of time, sir, since the patient is 71 years old.
You are discussing. I think Kamala is discussing. Yeah.
Sir, looks like he is trying to say that prostate is not a cause of hematuria, the way he is writing with no issue of retention.
No.
In a 70-year male hematuria, non-painless hematuria.
No, why would, whether it is a prostate or a kidney or a bladder, what is that? Is only the severity of hematuria. Suppose the patient has a large volume bleed and then there is a clot formation. Anything can produce a clot. It need not be only the prostate nor the bladder or kidney. Any severe hematuria can produce a clot and clot retention. So it doesn't rule out BPH or all those things. But yeah,
The way he is presenting, no history of obstructive LUTs. No retention, he is taking prostate route.
Okay. Then? So why, see in this, in addition to hematuria, why there is a nocturia contact?
So I don't know the patient how much polydipsy or, and I don't know further history, like to have more history, sir. Since he's a gross painless hematuria, 70 years of age and male, I would like to know first of all whether he's a smoker or not.
Yeah, okay, but a smoker or non-smoker.
Sir, see,
there is there. It will increase the chance. But it
So I initially tried to ask him that the irritative symptoms came before hematuria or they were along with hematuria. The reason being that the CIS or bladder tumor present with irritative symptoms.
Don't use irritative. Irritates. No. Use what?
Storage symptoms.
Use proper term. Don't use, okay. So what are other differences you think? Quickly. One you said tumor, one you said?
BPH can be there, sir.
No, other thing.
Tuberculosis, sir. That are two.
So how do you stop? How do you classify it rather than saying this can be there, can be there, can be there? How do you classify it at this age, in this particular patient?
First is in this will be benign prostate hyperplasia. Second will be bladder malignancy.
See, whenever a fellow has a gross hematuria, the first until otherwise proved, it is bladder cancer. Why you want to put BPH in the number one list?
Sir, in 2000.
No, that too in a patient who has frequent hematuria.
Yes.
The last
recurrent. Yes, sir.
Putting something else in the first is a little bit controversial. Always, a bladder is much, much common. You may be right, but I'm not saying.
Yes, sir.
But your diagnosis should be
malignancy
number one, rather than BPH. If it turns out to be something like infection,
yes,
something so on, it is well and good.
Yes,
but in exam, more often than not, it is a malignancy. Okay, anyway, one is malignant. You have told bladder tumor, right? No, BPH. You know,
BPH. Okay. Sir, bladder cycle calculus.
Hmm.
Then it could be bladder TB, sir. Infective etiologies.
Hmm. Yeah.
Then it could be, sir, infective etiology like UTI only. But I don't know why it's painless. UTI will have painful.
Okay, yeah, we'll come down. But why
is
so much
of nocturia? Sir, I am not aware that maybe other combinant diseases are there in patient. Okay. He's a diabetic, uncontrolled diabetic, or he's a polydipsic.
What contributing factors, what I meant is whether somebody has advised him to drink a lot of water.
Yes.
So he may be
drinking a lot of water.
That itself may be possible. Anyhow, possibility, but sometimes the patients will tell you, because I'm having nocturia, I have reduced my intake. So that patient still says he has to get up, then there's something wrong. So, right.
And there is no history of fever, no history of nausea or vomiting, no history of breathlessness or stasis, no history of bony pain, plant pain, and there is no any history of tuberculosis.
See, when you say painless hematuria, then you don't have to say that there is no plank pain, correct? If there is a plank pain, it will not qualify as a painless.
Yes.
Okay, anyway. Yeah, I think there's nothing to discuss with this.
The patient is on anticoagulant medication since 10 years. For some cerebrovascular accident, he is on a tablet aspirin and clopidogrel, sir, and he is regularly taking this medicine. And no further detailed history of any that accident, what disease he had, he don't have their reports. And patient is known diabetic and hypertensive, and he is on medication.
See, I think long back before, it is better to qualify what drugs the patient is on, right? Now, this anticoagulant means what? Now, 10 years, hematuria will not be because of the anticoagulant per se. So, if a patient with anticoagulant, if he has hematuria, you continue to investigate the patient irrespective of the what medications he is on, rather than blaming the anticoagulant as the cause for hematuria. Having said that, you should be giving the details of medications for the patient on. Can you tell, okay, Kamal, what drugs can cause the hematuria and other things in urology, diabetic drugs?
So pioglitazone.
It is known to cause?
So bladder malignancies.
But which diabetic drug is known to cause UTI?
SGLT. Yeah, GLAFOFN, suffix.
Yes. So, it's what? You cannot just pass it on saying diabetic hypertensive drugs. Now, if I want to see this patient has got nocturia, whether he has been taking some diuretics in the night or not, which may be hydrochlorothiazide, whatever. So, the medications has to be asked, unless the patient doesn't know, has he not brought all those things. But, you know, another thing, whether these are under control. Now, whether you are looking at a patient who has got storage symptoms, if this is because of uncontrolled diabetes, does it not make a difference? You can just cannot pass a statement saying diabetic hypertension and leave it at that. We need to know the duration of diabetes, the medications, everything. Okay, it is not just I am looking at only the urological perspective. If a patient has any comorbid illness, I have to know the details and severity. Let us say the cerebral vascular accident, the patient is bedridden. Patient is incontinent. Incontinent for the last, I mean, you have told the history, but I'm telling. So whether he has recovered, whether he's ambulant, whether he has residual paralysis, all those things are important. Just don't pass it on because you're deciding on managing the patient. You need to decide whether it's fit to be operated or not. So you can't. You need to know the fitness perspective also, the details of all this. Anyway, so what else is missing in that history? No, that okay. Beyond, before the personal history, yeah.
The occupation is missing. And
okay, what you don't, what is the occupation of this patient?
Sir, I have given him the personal history, the bank clerk.
Oh, okay, right. Okay, you asked then, what else?
Then, sir, smoking, he has given the personal history. Second, third thing, from here, where is he from? So, geological factor also matters. Where is he from?
He is from Erode.
He's from?
Erode. So, you know about Erode, so simply asking one thing, you should be able to, you don't know where is Erode only, then you'll have to travel.
So, if Middle East is there, matters, and if it is from Bangladesh, Taiwan, they matters.
That is if you are an international consultant. No? Okay. Anyhow, what is the intake of this patient? It's very important. Yeah. So that, I don't think if it has not come till now, it is going to come in your personal and other things. Okay, anyway, proceed.
The appetite is decreased, sir, and patient also complain of occasional constipation. The history of smoking for the last 40 years, and he takes on an average 5 cigarettes per day, and patient is bank clerk by occupation.
No, he's a retired man. You cannot be plan clerk at 72. Okay. So, good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. So, what else you would like to ask Kamal? Again, these parts of it are routinely missed, that's why I'm asking. Now, next you want to go and examine this patient, obviously, correct?
No, sir. Family history of malignancy.
Okay.
Any family history of malignancy?
No family history of
any such. Okay. Anything else?
Yeah. Any significant weight loss is there?
Okay.
Since appetite is low.
No, sir.
If he has documented it, well enough. Okay, anything?
So any initial treatment he has taken?
Yeah, the treatment history. You think this patient who had hemicuria will keep quiet for the next 6 months?
They have one episode of hemicuria 6 months back, but he didn't take any treatment.
Sometimes, you know, these patients would have undergone some surgical intervention, mainly urological, and they will keep quiet to find out what you have to say. So, you'll have to specifically asked what was done, what medications were done, was he admitted, was he whatever endoscopic surgery was done, you will be surprised, all this would have been done, including BCG, that, this and all. So you have to be asking straight questions. What did you do? Okay. And very, okay. Somebody. Okay. Well. So at the end of all major cases, please ask loss of appetite, loss of weight, cough, hemoptysis, fetal edema, low back pain for every case. You don't know in which case it will help you. That's the routine. Okay.
In general examination, patient conscious, alert, cooperative, and oriented to time, place, and person. The blood pressure is 150 by 80 mercury. Pulse rate is 78 per minute regular. Performance status ECOG 0, and there is no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, edema, or any sign of dehydration or cervical lymphedema. On for abdominal examination, abdomen soft, non-tender, no mass or lump palpable, there is no organomegaly, no any suprapubic fullness. On digital rectal examination, the perineal sensation felt, anal tone normal, no prostatomegaly, no any mass felt, and the rectal mucosa mobile. The genitalia refuse is retractable, glans and soft, shaft normal. Meatus normal, both testes palpable, normal and non-tender.
Anyhow, the you should not go from parabdomen to DRE and genitalia. Anyhow, doesn't matter. Right. So, Kamal, what quick differentials? Any change in what you thought, or you same?
So, one thing, prostate is not palpable.
Not enlarged. So does it rule out anything? Only thing is it may be not malignancy of the prostate. That's all. BPH still can be possible.
And there is no suprapubic fullness. Maybe bladder is not palpable, meaning that he's emptying his bladder. Since the nocturia was there and...
So what all you want quickly? I mean, what are the differential first and then investigate?
Sir, bladder malignancy is still will be the first.
Just enlighten. I mean, just go with the list.
Sir, bladder malignancy, cycle calculus.
Gross painless hematuria with clots. You would not put vesicle calculus as a second diagnosis without any pain. Agree, bladder tumor first. Gross painless hematuria with clots is malignancy otherwise proved, unless otherwise proved in urology. Right?
Yes, sir. So, GUTB can be there?
No, sir. It's not the second diagnosis.
Benign prostate hyperplasia, sir.
But bladder tumor, you don't want to have a renal tumor?
What, sir?
See, what happens is you are looking at this case. You have a smoker, 72 years. You always go with the case in hand. Now what happens? You are thinking as hematuria, what are the causes in general? No. You are still with the case. You are giving differentials. In this case, what are the possibilities?
This RCC can also present with maturity.
Certainly, but, it can. It has to be a top of the list diagnosis.
Sir, but lower tract symptoms along with...
what? So what? Blood itself is an irritant. Blood itself is an irritant. If he's having clots and all that.
Now I can hear you.
Okay.
I think Dr. Ganesh had to set off my audio.
Oh, I see.
As soon as you came on, I started hearing, otherwise I couldn't follow. There was hardly any sound. Okay. No, I think the point is, just because we had one case in which there was gross hematuria and turned out tuberculosis, don't put that on top of your list.
Okay, sir.
This is a problem when we get unusual cases.
Okay, then. So you said RCC, bladder tumor, RCC, then?
Sir, BPH, sir.
Between bladder tumor and RCC, is there anything else that can happen? Give rise to hematuria?
Yes, sir, upper tract malignancy.
Yeah, why don't you put that there? He's a smoker, so he's prone to urothelial dysplasias, and the tumors can be at any place in the urothelium or at multiple places. See, you have to let the examiner know that you know all these things.
Yes.
If you happen to go for the FRCS exam and you say vesicle calculus, BPH and TB as your diagnosis, they will send you over. So it is malignancy first, always.
So I'll proceed with this diagnosis.
Fine.
And I'll ask for an imaging, sir. Ultrasound, I would like to see. Ultrasound.
Oh, okay. You are again in trouble. Whenever you want investigation, ask for
blood and urine.
Always. Okay. So why not directly take him for cystoscopy then? Why you want ultrasound? You need to know whether his diabetes is controlled, his renal function is normal, his hemoglobin status, everything. He's on anticoagulant. What drugs do you use? Just what?
The thing was sitting there, so money was great
to okay, proceed. Next
lecture. On blood investigation, sir, the hemoglobin is 13.3 gram per day. Total WBC count is 9,700 platelets at 217,000. Urea and creatinine are within normal limit. At the SGOT, SGPT 34 and 40 international units. Sodium 139, potassium 4.3. Activated pulses for plasticine time 39.6 seconds. ATINR 13.6 seconds. Bleeding time 2 minutes 22 seconds and clotting time 4 minutes 46 seconds.
Amal, why are they doing this bleeding time and clotting time after doing the thromboplastin and partial thromboplastin time?
I think it's the usual master health checkup, sort of draw the blood and send it to the lab. In the US, they call it SMA 24-36.
Oh, yeah.
SMAC 36.
Yeah. But what I want to also ask Kamal is, supposing somebody is on antiplatelet agents, is there any way you can know whether that's likely to cause bleeding?
Very good question.
Sir, platelet dysfunction test, sir, can tell me that risk or
test? I don't know.
That is the only way. That is the only way to know. By doing a platelet count and all that you want, but you will be altered bleeding time. Bleeding time gets altered, and that is more significant.
Clot retraction time.
All those things are there. Platelet dysfunction tests are specific.
So going back, the history of medications, what the patient is on, it should be important, and that should decide what test you want to specifically do.
Yes.
If the patient is on...
what's the difference between warfarin and heparin in the test that you will do?
Yes, sir.
What will you do for warfarin and what will you do for heparin?
Sir, warfarin, I will check INRP, prothrombin time, and...
PTINR. Okay.
Yeah, APTT for heparin, sir.
Okay. Yeah, we've got this. Maybe we can move on, Prabhu?
Yes,
sir. To complete the urine analysis, sir.
Why do you want to do a urine analysis?
Sir, just to confirm that the patient has come with gross hematuria, like he is not confused with red color, sir.
Use the word confused.
See, he's got clots here. He can't be confused. If it was red urine, I'll agree.
Suppose you find no hemorrhage, no blood cells in the urine, in the sample that you've taken, you will ignore the symptoms?
No, sir.
Then,
I will not ignore the symptoms.
Please answer the question that Dr. Mohan asked you. The primary reason for doing the urine, you may or may not confirm, but the patient has told you to get clots. But more importantly, some other factors are there in the urine which help you. That's why you want to do the urine.
So I look for WBCs, sir, along RBCs.
Macroscopic hematuria, you will get WBCs, and you may not get either WBCs or RBCs if it is between episodes. Correct.
Yeah,
so what is it that you're looking for?
On the routine examination,
sir. The gross hematuria will mask the WBCs and... Now I'm interested, sir. If gross hematuria, I will be interested more in malignancies, sir. So I will like for ultrasound abdomen, sir.
Suppose in the urine there was 3 plus of albumin, man.
Yes, sir.
There is 3 plus albumin in the urine.
So medical causes of hematuria.
No, we are still...
We are still in urology department.
Urology course. Nephrologist has sent it back. Urologist.
Renal. RCC with renal thrombosis. Renal thrombosis.
What are the conditions where you get massive proteinuria or albuminuria?
Sir, RCC, sir.
With
renal vein thrombosis.
What else? See, you're going to be asked this because everywhere you'll say urine routine microscopy. And clearly, if the examiner asks you, he's got something in mind. What is it that he has in mind? What is normal with hematuria? What of these findings can be abnormal even in the presence of hematuria? When do they become abnormal? How will you interpret this? Read up here.
Yes, sir. Sir, HbA1c also, I like to know, sir, the glycemic control of the patient.
Okay.
The present sugar patient was under control. He was on medication and sugar level was under
control. See, Kamal.
Yes, sir.
Don't bring in the small things when there is a large picture in front of you.
Got it, sir.
You will need that at a time when you've decided on intervention. If HbA1c is 10, then you'll wait until diabetes control to investigate him further? You won't.
No, sir. Yes, sir.
That comes at the time of management. So what next?
Sir, ultrasound abdomen, sir. Pelvis. So both kidneys are normal in shape, size, with CMD maintained, no hydronephrosis.
Is there any difference between the right and left kidney? May not be pathological. Is there any difference?
That also
you see the bifid system in the right kidney? The sinus is split. Yeah. Okay, those are interesting things which you should be able to pick up. In the odd case, this might become important for you. Okay.
This is the image of bladder and right prostate. Partially distended bladder.
No, let him tell you. Kamal, you have to give your findings. See, to save time in the examination, if there is something positive, come out with that positive thing first. And if the examiner is interested, I'll ask you about the rest of it.
Sir, there is a hypoechoic lesion at the base of bladder, sir.
What?
Hypoechoic lesion at the base of the bladder, sir.
Not hypoechoic. What is it? You can't say lesion. You have to describe its morphology. There is a space-occupying lesion arising from the base of the bladder, which is hypoechoic, hyperechoic, isoechoic, or mixed echogenicity.
It's a hypoechoic, sir.
Did you say so?
Hypoechoic.
Sir, as compared to bladder wall, it looks hypoechoic.
No. See, you see the image on the last image that's on the left of the screen. Look at the characteristic there. You compare it with the image lower column on the lower row on the right. It's the same mass, one is axial, one is coronal. So you see.
Sir, both images are not axial, sir.
I can't move my pointer here.
Yes, sir.
Can you see the urethra in the last image?
Lord.
Not there. Further right. To the left.
Right side.
Last
image.
Last
down.
Yeah.
Little down.
That's
a
urethra.
A
long line.
Horizontal line.
It's oblique. That's a urethra.
Okay.
See that starting from the bladder, going down until it disappears into the perineal muscles. Anyway, we may not quibble about longitudinal or transverse, but what about the lesion itself? It is an elevated lesion, which is isoechoic in some areas, and in other areas it is hypoechoic. So it's got variegated echogenicity, correct?
Yes, sir.
Because in the first image, in the bottom row, you see that there are some areas which are hypoechoic. We don't know whether that's urine or whether it's part of the lesion. We assume it's part of the lesion because the lesion is an elevated lesion. That is why we do an axial scan. In the axial scan, you can see the entire image and it appears isoechoic. Supposing it was hypoechoic, what else would you be looking for?
Sir, I can't hear, sir.
Supposing it was hyperechoic, what would you be looking for?
Cycle calculus and posterior shadow.
On ultrasound, what will you look for?
Shadow, sir. Posterior shadow.
Right. So whenever you find anything hyperechoic, you look for posterior acoustic shadowing. And in a soft tissue mass, which is isodense, you look for any focal calcifications.
Yes, sir. And second thing, sir, we are looking for a mass in a post-voided scan, sir. In a distended bladder, it will be better.
Okay. You can make that observation that the bladder is not adequately distended. But because of that, you can't dismiss what you're seeing.
Exactly.
Right? Yes. If it was only wall thickening, I'll accept your argument. Bladder is not distended, that's why the wall appears thicker than normal. But here, we are looking at a space occupying lesion.
Plus, I have to change the position and check whether it is mobile or
it is only if it's hyperechoic, not for every lesion. Come on, don't make that mistake.
The clots.
See, don't make that mistake. Yeah, for clots, they may or may not move. You could do yes. that. What else can you do to confirm the nature or differentiate clot from tumor?
So vascularity, sir. I'll look for Doppler scan. I'll change the mode of the scan.
Look. You'll do a Doppler and look at the flow. If the lesion shows flow within, then it's likely to be a tumor. If there is no flow, it's likely to be a clot, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
There is a distended bladder now.
But there is something more. Again, in the bottom row, I think you guys have put the first film second and the second film first.
Yes. This is the mass that which is maybe you are seeing in the post-void image.
What is that mass? Now we have got a good picture.
Yes. It's a solitary and hypoechoic.
Can it be any benign tissue?
Yes, sir, it can be.
What is it? If it is
benign. Sir, it can be the medial lobe projecting into the bladder.
Can be or likely to be?
Sir, likely to be.
Why is it?
Base of the bladder, sir.
What else? See, they have done a Doppler.
And seeing
the Doppler, you can see the ureteric jet, but there is no vascularity seen in that solid protruding lesion, right?
Yes, sir.
It's in the midline, and here you can see it protruding into the lumen of the bladder. No added vascularity. It's isodense or isoechoic. Correct?
Yes, sir.
How will you confirm it's a middle lobe? How will you confirm that this is actually the median lobe? You said no, it's possible the prostate and median lobe. How will you confirm it's the median lobe?
Cystoscopically, sir?
No. Before cystoscopy.
Sir, I'll change my axis.
change the axis of the bro. Okay, you will do sagittal sections and you will see this thing projecting through the bladder neck.
Yes, sir.
And in continuity with the rest of the prostate.
Yes, sir.
Some things can be projecting through that but not having continuity with the prostate. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Would you like to do any other investigation?
Sir, CT scan I will ask, sir, because it is a bladder-based tumor.
See, he's in the ultrasound suite. Would you like to do any enhanced imaging with the modality available to you there?
After ultrasound, sir, I will like do CT scan.
During ultrasound. See, the question here is you don't know whether it's a median lobe or whether it is something else. Right?
Yes, sir.
Is there any ultrasound technique or modality which will give you a better answer?
Contrast ultrasound?
No.
Contrast ultrasound is to see the lesion of the urethra.
Yeah, not this. Can you put ultrasound in some other orifice? Can you put some other ultrasound in some other orifice?
You use a different probe, put it somewhere else.
Trust can be done to look for prostate cell.
Trust can be or will be when you have a doubt.
A doubt like this, what else can you do sitting there?
Yes, trust can help us to diagnose prostate malignancy or the ecotexture of prostate.
Malignancy, Kamal, you're missing the point. Your interest here is to know whether it is contiguous with the prostate or separate from the prostate.
Yes, sir. It can help us, sir.
Yeah, so transrectal ultrasound will give you a closer image of the prostate and help you arrive at this. You could still not have an answer if it is contiguous with the prostate and there is something else that you pick up, like vascularity or something. By and large, when you do a transrectal ultrasound, you can see the urethra, you can see the lobes of the prostate, you can see whether this is contiguous, and if you move the probe a little laterally away from the prostate, you might be able to pick this up separately if it is in the bladder base.
Yes, sir.
Would you like to do urine cytology for this patient?
Yes, sir, I would like to do it. Not for diagnosis, but for to know the grade or for follow-up, sir.
For diagnosis. Supposing for the urine cytology is positive. Supposing the report back as urine cytology is positive, but you don't think it's diagnosis? Huh?
It will just tell me the grade, sir.
Anything in addition to grade, Baba?
Diagnosis, man. Psychologist is totally psychologist positive. What more do you want?
But what is it? It will warn you about. Cytology comes positive. One is, of course, the grade, whatever, etc. Anything else that will ring alarm bells?
Yeah, it tells me, sir, I am dealing with a malignancy.
Hey, come on. Can it be because of a coexisting upper tract malignancy?
Yes,
it can
sir.
Be a UTUC, yes, right?
Yes, sir.
There is no hydranephrosis. That doesn't mean there can't be tumors in the ureter or a small one somewhere in the pelvis or calyx, which is not picked up on ultrasound, right? That is the value of cytology, not just to know the grade of the tumor here, which anyway you will get when you do a biopsy, but to know whether additional imaging is required to establish presence of tumor in other sites.
Remember, cytology is a specific test. It gives you if the cytology is positive, it is positive.
Yes, sir.
Yes, so you can't just ignore it and say, oh, maybe an artifact. Cytologists will not report it like that. Yeah, most of the cytopathologists are very learned. If they are sure, only they will report. If they are not sure, they will not report. So once you get a report like that, it's your duty to take action on it. Either you want to repeat it again, normally that's what people do, but you cannot ignore it. That is the problem. Okay?
Yes, sir. So my point was, if it cytology even come negative, I'll proceed with CT scan since the ultrasound is showing one bladder mass, sir.
Well, you got some shares in that CT scan machine, huh?
No,
we have CT scan, boss. Huh? You don't want to do PSA on this patient? The world's most popular test today is PSA. You don't want that?
Yes, sir, it is also required.
Yeah, I'm asking you, you're saying yes.
Sir, it is a posterior wall tumor and patient has come with hematuria, 70 years of age. Sir, I would also do a PSA, sir.
You saw the ultrasound, no, of this patient?
Yes, sir.
On the ultrasound, you mentioned about the bladder not being filled properly.
Yes.
You look at the volume of the bladder that they have shown on this ultrasound. they marked it, no, there? Very small volume, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
How much is it? I think the previous slide, sir.
It's very blurred, 156.
No, where is it? We looked at the previous slide. Here they only said length. Where is the volume? The previous one. You see volume. 25.68 ml.
This is post-wide, sir.
Post-wide, oh, sorry, okay.
This is post-wide and this is the volume of the mass they are measuring, sir.
What about the pre-wide?
Sir, this is the pre-wide.
They haven't mentioned the volume here.
No, sir.
Right. Supposing I tell you that the pre-void and the post-void of this patient was small and he's got this lesion.
Sir,
what is the alarm bell that will ring in your mind?
Sir, it alarms that it is infiltrating the muscle and maybe beyond, which is preventing it to distend.
So which sort of malignancy tends to do that?
So muscle invasive bladder tumor, sir.
Which bladder tumor? Sarcoma. Which type of bladder tumor, man? Leiomyosarcoma, rhabdomyosarcoma. Which malignancy does that?
Sorry, sir, I don't know, sir. I'll read it.
What you don't know, man? Urothelial, man. I want to use the right words.
Urothelial
malignancy. You can't just say muscle invasive. All these tumors are muscle invasive. Rhabdomyosarcoma, leiomyosarcoma. You have to be very specific, man.
It's got it, sir.
Yeah, no, you see, it's very important to know this. Otherwise, what will happen is tomorrow you will be making the same mistake. You will just say everything is like this, then. No. The idea of all these sessions is to make sure that we are all on the same wavelength. That is urothelial malignancy, and it's a very high grade of malignancy which tends to do this. If the bladder volume is small, the patient has got LUTS, he's got hematuria, he's got this mass lesion which is, you know, not very clear, it is indescript. Somebody saying it's in the prostate, somebody saying the base of the bladder. In these sort of situations, the cytology will help. If the cytology is positive, it adds to your diagnosis. I'm not denying the fact that you will be doing a CT scan, but we're still on the ultrasound. So all the values of the ultrasound have to be taken into account. Because your rectal examination findings are normal.
Could it be carcinoma in situ?
So along with this mass, maybe, sir.
Small capacity bladder. Could it be due to CIS?
Yes, sir. It can be, sir.
So we have a lot of things before us to evaluate, right?
Yes.
Will it show up on CT scan? CIS?
No, sir. It is cystoscopic finding, sir. And biopsy.
Is there any difference in technique of the CT scan for a bladder tumor and for a suspected upper tract urothelial tumor? We've discussed this, I think, approximately 6 months ago. 6-8 months ago, we discussed this. When we spoke about imaging in urology, we spoke about the different techniques of CT and CT to be done when we suspect upper tract malignancy.
Okay, sir.
No, I'm asking you, what technique will you use? Or will you specifically tell the radiographer?
Sir, for upper tracts, I would like to, that's delayed images, sir. CT urogram will tell me
what
the filling
rate. What is delayed image?
I'll read, sir, this.
It has to be part of your everyday practice also coming. Okay?
Yes, sir.
I think CT is not enough. You should know, because we spoke at length on this techniques in CT, what to do when, for what lesions, how do we tailor the CT according to the suspected lesion. Read about it and you'll tell us next time.
Yes, sir. I will read and come back.
5 minutes quickly, or you can just put up a table that for this condition, this is what we'll do. Okay. Yeah. Go up, please. Can we start on the kidneys if the images are earlier? Yeah.
The only thing.
Never start with the only thing. Describe what you see.
This is CCT abdomen axial sections. Arterial phase, sir, in which both kidneys are enhancing well, and I mean good uptake of contrast.
First of all, you will say what phase this has been taken in.
Sir, arterial phase, sir.
Why arterial phase? You are seeing the whole of the parenchyma opacified. You will see the aorta, whichever phase it is. But in an arterial phase, you don't. Do you expect to see the entire parenchyma opacified?
Nephrogenic phase.
Do you see the ureter opacified?
No, sir.
Check. Check again.
No, sir. Ureter is not. This is ureter pelvis.
Hmm.
Not opacified.
Last image. What is it you are seeing? Upper row. Last image, left kidney.
Yes. Yeah.
What is that streak of contrast? Not that. Just below that. Just below that.
Below?
Below that. Yeah, that. What is that?
The renal vessel, sir. I mean.
Renal vessel. Correspondingly, look on this side. The previous image. Left side.
Left side.
Third image on the left side. What is that? Not that, below that. Yeah. The dot that you see.
I'm not sure it is ureter, sir.
I'm not sure it is ureter.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, right. Move on.
Then I'll move to comment on bladder, sir, now.
Yeah, you're the boss.
One new finding, sir, apart from the ultrasound, we have a mass at the bladder anterior wall, sir.
Yes.
With enhancement and with perivesical extension, sir.
Yes, see, it's very interesting. See what else is there. See the last image on the top row, the third and fourth images on the last row, on the top row.
Yes, sir. There is the perivesical extension and no fat plane between the muscle. And
what else is there? Tumor. Look at the anterior abdominal wall in the first two slices. In the last two slices in the top row.
So there is a asymmetry between the muscles of the left and the right rectus.
Sir, it's
canvas.
I missed this.
almost touching, abutting the sir muscle.
There is asymmetry and the thing appears to be touching the muscle with no fat plane. What does it suggest to you?
Sir, T4.
Forget about staging.
Dominant wall.
Talk about, again you are going away.
What structure is there in the anterior abdominal wall, man, which is related to the bladder and to these lesions?
You can make out very well if you also look at the first image and the second image in the second row. And Dr. Ganesh's question.
Is there a constant anatomical landmark there?
Yes, sir. Erectus.
When you see something like this, it immediately flash in your mind.
Sir, it could be, sir, erectus which connecting the dome of the bladder with the umbilicus.
Yeah, obviously. Suppose, in what other situation will you get adherence of a tumor like this to the anterior abdominal wall?
Sir, urethral adenocarcinoma?
I agree. Finish that. That's over. I'm asking you another question. In what other situation will you get adherence of this sort of a lesion to the anterior abdominal wall? How does it happen? What is urethral adenocarcinoma, urethral carcinoma, urothelial? What other situation will it happen?
Urethral diverticulum, urethral cyst, infected urethral cyst.
Anything else?
Other than urethral.
In what other situations will you get adherence of this anterior of the bladder to the anterior abdominal wall?
A T4 bladder tumor, sir.
Okay, T4, right. Number two, anything else? Any other way?
Sir, if I have under any prior interventions, suprapubic,
right,
catheterization or something.
Right. What sort of situation does that happen? Which sort of tumor does that happen sometimes?
Sir,
where a suprapubic is put inside for something. Hello? You put a suprapubic tube for something, for some other condition.
Sir, if patient having some history of long-standing suprapubic for bladder obstruction due to stone or...
Right.
Neurogenic bladder, sir. Maybe.
So, any situation where there is a constant irritation. So the suprapubic tube, especially if there is a problem with the bladder lining, if there is a stone there, stones can produce squamous carcinoma and this can infiltrate in there. Some intervention can also cause this. If by mistake you have done a cystotomy for a superficial bladder tumor, then it can get adherent and that tumor can become invasive later on. So these are all reasons why you have adherence of the bladder wall to the, I mean the bladder to the anterior abdominal wall, okay, apart from urethras.
Sir, I would like to add, apart from this mass, there is one base mass which is also enhancing, but I could not see any large lymph nodes along the
iliac. No. Tell us about the mass enhancing, what else? Hey, you have stopped just saying raising
mass. Enhancing with mixed density, sir, with central hypodensities.
See, once contrast is given, very difficult to comment about density. You can only comment about uptake of contrast.
Kamal.
Yes, sir.
You asked for a CT scan to decipher that lesion that you saw on the ultrasound, right?
Yes, sir.
The ultrasound was grossly inadequate in this patient because it has missed so much of facts.
Yes, sir.
But it did not miss that base of the bladder lesion. So yeah. Comment on the base of the bladder lesion which you saw on the ultrasound and now you see it. Are you seeing it on the CT scan? Where do you think it could be? Describe that. Yeah. You have not come to that. That's what Mohan is asking you. There's other things there in the CT.
Yes.
So, look at it.
Sir, the posterior wall of the bladder, there is a mass which is sessile and enhancing with irregularities, surface, and it appears separate from the prostate, sir. It doesn't look like it's arising from the prostate and impinging into the bladder.
Something else is happening with the mass and the bladder.
So this is extending up till more high till dome, sir. This mass is in
something else
all along the posterior surface till dome.
Which you characterize not about high or low. Something else is happening along with the mass. Compare the left side of the bladder, right side of the bladder, bladder wall on the left, bladder wall on the right. Go to the second row. Look at the middle two images or even the first three images on the second row.
Sir, is this involving a complete right posterior lateral wall, sir?
Third, second row, first, second and third images. Can you see the thickening of the bladder wall on that side contiguous with the tumor?
Yes, sir, exactly.
Right?
Yes, sir.
So what does the thickening indicate or what could it indicate?
It could be CIS, sir.
It could be?
CIS, sir.
Sorry?
Sir, carcinoma in situ can present.
No, be more obvious or more likely. The CI is a flat mucosal lesion. You won't find it elevated, you know, the bladder wall thickened and so on like this, unless there are other pathologies. But if you find a tumor in the base of the bladder with thickening of the bladder wall contiguous with it, what is it likely to be? It's likely to be infiltration, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
In bladder outlet obstruction, there are two diagnoses possible. Bladder outlet obstruction with bladder thickening or infiltration causing bladder thickening. Bladder outlet obstruction will be uniform on both sides. All around the bladder, you'll find thickening. If it is preferentially to one side, contiguous with the tumor, likely to be infiltration. Right?
Yes, sir.
Now the next question in your mind is, are the two tumors the same? It's just that we see them differently in different cuts, or are they two different tumors? That's the question you have to answer.
So these are two separate tumors, sir. One at the posterior wall, one at the anterior wall.
Do they have the same CT characteristics?
What, sir? I didn't get.
Do they have the same CT characteristics?
Yes, sir. Similar amount of enhancement, sir.
Check again, see whether the CT characteristics are the same with what you're seeing in the anterior wall and what you're seeing in the bladder base or posterior wall.
So both are sessile and...
See, that's morphology. When we say CT characteristics, we usually mean the opacification and the washout. This is what you can make out in CT. Look at the two and see whether the two are the same. The anterior wall tumor definitely seems to be opacifying more than what's in the base, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
That's why, so look at 1, 2, 3 in the middle row.
With central, sir.
Or even 4.
Hypointensity.
Can you put it inside
there? The
highest contrast uptake.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
There are areas which are
isolated.
There are areas which are opacified and some which don't appear to be opacified. You find the same thing in the lower tumor also?
No, sir. And lower tumor is uniformly enhancing, sir.
Appears to be uniformly enhancing, isn't it? Yes. Except if you see the fourth film in the top row.
Sir, this is at the dome and posterior wall, sir.
Yeah, so the posterior wall also, there is some gap in the enhancement, if you can see. But that could just be because of the axis in which the cut has been taken. But otherwise, grossly, the anterior wall tumor is enhancing more than the mass lesion we are seeing in the posterior wall.
See, exactly. Yes.
Right.
With the perivesical extension, sir.
Will settle. We said it's involving the anterior abdominal wall. That means there is perivesical extension, or it might have arisen from the anterior abdominal wall and got into the bladder. We'll resolve that a little later.
That would be less likely because we have a...
We'll resolve that later. Go on. What else do you find?
I am not able to find any large lymph nodes along the iliac vessels, sir.
Okay. What else will you look for in the pelvic cuts, especially when there is a mass at the bladder base?
Sir, fat plane between the prostate and the seminal vesicle and the mass.
Both are the seminal vesicles distended?
No, sir.
I'm taking a small break. There's a call I have to answer. Others can continue.
Yes.
Kamal.
Yes, sir.
See, as a now exam going candidate, in a couple of months you will be a consultant, or you will be faced with a situation like this. You must have certain thoughts that go through your mind when you see a CT scan like this. Apart from the fact that it's likely to be some advanced bladder malignancy, there are certain features which are a little strange. You've got a lesion in the base of the bladder, all right? And yes, as you take the cuts down, it seems to be taking away some of the planes between the bladder and the rectum. You see the rectum gas there, but the fat plane around the rectum seems to be obliterated, especially on the anterior wall as you go down, all right? Such a lesion in that particular location with such an advanced lesion in the bladder, what is absolutely surprising is the fact that there is no hydronephrosis. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
You dilated ureter, they showed you the ureteric jet, everything was there on the ultrasound, and the kidney did not look hydronephrotic. So, you know, when you are going for, when you're looking at a situation like this, these are the thoughts that must come through your mind, and these are the thoughts that you must echo to the, or vocalize to the person who is asking you the question. So you keep reading the x-ray and he says, these are the worrying, these are some of the red flags here. At the same time, I don't see any hydronephrosis. So does it mean that we are looking at a different diagnosis? Does it mean we are looking at some other sort of disease? Where is it? Why is it not? Because anybody, when you see a lesion like this, will say, gosh, there's going to be hydronephrosis. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So you will have to vocalize these thoughts also.
Yes.
Right. So will you do a PSA for this man now?
No, sir.
Can he have two tumors? Can he have two malignancies?
Sir, he can have, but as per the CT, it looks like primary bladder tumor only.
Suppose it's prostatic cancer infiltrating the bladder base.
But the base tumor is smaller and less severe as compared to the anterior and dome one.
So you don't think it's necessary to do a PSA in this patient?
The examination is normal and I have a significant finding on CT, sir.
Right. So, the way you will answer that question, he's got something more serious and important. Unless we are looking at two malignancies in such a patient, the rectal examination is normal. I would focus on the lesion that is more serious and apparent on the CT scan than actually at the base of the bladder. It may be the same lesion that is there in the base of the bladder, which is there on the anterior wall and the lateral walls. Okay.
Yes.
So what are you going to do now? Obviously.
Sir, I'll do cystoscopy and biopsy. And as per the CT, looks like it...
You will do anything else? You'll just cystoscopy and biopsy, or you'll do cystoscopy and something else?
Sir, I will not go for... Sir, TURBT in this, I will take biopsy with supervision and deep cuts.
You will not do TURBT, eh?
Sir, It looks like it is involving more than 50% of the bladder tumor, sir. Bladder wall.
You take biopsy then.
Sir, TUR biopsy and early radical cystectomy, sir.
No, no, no. How will you take biopsy?
Sir, of course, sir, TUR BT, but my plan, intention will not to be doing for radical.
We're not asking about
your intention. How will you answer that question, man? You directly said, I will do cystoscopy biopsy, but I will not do TUR BT.
Sir, I got wrong.
If you had put it better, these issues would not have arisen. If it is
favorable
biopsy, you just take a pinch biopsy, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Biopsy, I was wrong by saying that.
Transurethral resection biopsy. All right. If you just take some bits from the top of the tumor on a biopsy with a pinch muscle, that's all you will get. You want to. This is obvious muscle invasive disease, whatever there is here on the CT scan. So you need it. And it's important to know on histology which variety it is. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
That's why you do a biopsy.
Yes, sir. Exactly.
You just don't do it just for the fun of it. You want to know which, is it a standard variant? Or is it a standard urothelial or is it a histological variant?
Yes, sir.
Or is it some other histological picture? You'll be surprised. Okay.
Got it, sir.
So the answer is I will do a resection biopsy. This will enable me to get representative areas of the bladder tumor as well as from the bladder base adjacent where there is likely to be infiltration of the muscle.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So have you histology done? Any findings on cystoscopy on this patient?
Sir, no, sir.
No?
No.
Biopsy?
No, sir.
Oh, I see. Okay. So we are in a state of limbo here at the moment.
Stop, please.
Right.
Supposing it turns out, Kamal.
Yes, sir.
That this is a sarcoma or this is spindle-shaped cells seen in the biopsy.
Sir, then I need to counsel the patient that this is...
counsel for anything, we have to counsel.
Poor prognosis. Poor prognostic, sir. I have to discuss
no, all that, yes. See, all that is part of counseling. We are asking about clinical management. How will you manage a patient where histopathologist has told you urothelial cells, malignant urothelial cells with several spindle-shaped cells seen in clumps. That is the biopsy report.
So then I'll
also that IHC is not involved. There is no muscle bundle seen. He can tell you that also.
Yeah.
He can also throw in that.
What are the spindle shaped cells? Which tumors are characteristically represented by the presence of spindle-shaped cells or a predominance of spindle-shaped variety of cells in the tumor?
Mesenchymal tumors, sir.
Oi.
Sir, sarcoma. Leiomyomas.
Yes. Sarcomas. Leiomyomas have holes of cells. Sarcomas typically have cells which show spindle shape. That's how the name sarcoma came up. Because they appear like smooth muscle cells. Okay. So if you get a urothelial tumor with spindle shaped cells, what are the possibilities? And that will tell you how to manage these cases. So the gist is, it could be either a sarcomatous differentiation of a urothelial carcinoma, or it could be a sarcoma present along with a urothelial carcinoma. Correct?
Yes, sir.
In either case, stage 4, what would be the approach to management?
It's a neoadjuvant chemotherapy to downstage and then radical cystectomy.
What is the intent in the cystectomy?
So intent will be depending on how the patient responds to the chemotherapy.
What is the intent of doing a cystectomy? Is it curative intent? Is it palliative intent? Or is it to get more tissue for further treatment?
Sir, if I'm able to downstage the tumor, like some tumors respond very well to chemotherapy, then it will be curative intent.
I'm asking you, what is the intent of doing a cystectomy, not of chemotherapy?
So it would not be curative, sir, if it is T4, sir.
Yeah. So it should be palliative, isn't it? Because he is presented with hematuria, he is likely to have further hematuria, even if this is treated partially. The chemotherapy is only to make the tumor smaller and create some planes where you can do a cystectomy.
Yes, sir.
Right? So you said you want to do a TUR in this patient. What all do you want to do doing a TUR biopsy?
So IHC, I can get immunohistochemistry.
During a TUR biopsy.
Sir, I'll be very careful, sir, to avoid over-distending of bladder.
Okay, all that we agree.
And
what else would you do? Before, during, after?
Sir, bimanual palpation, sir.
Yeah, it's a must, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
I mean, you did a PR on this fellow and found nothing at all. But you look at the CT scan and you find so much of disease. It's obvious that you need to examine him very carefully under anesthesia. Isn't it? Sir. EUA is very important, man. Everybody just puts a scope in the urethra but doesn't feel bimanual. Anyway, nowadays nobody does all these things. You know?
So can I say like that? This is a very subjective finding. If I have such a nice CT scan, so
don't give commentary in the exam. You say, I want to do a EUA and cystoscopy, the EUA to be done before introducing the scope and at the end of my resection.
Supposing you find under anesthesia bimanually that the bladder is fixed to the pelvic side walls. Huh? Your cystectomy that you're going to do could be disastrous, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
You may cut through tumor, you may be leaving behind tumor. So with that chemotherapy, neoadjuvant chemotherapy, you'll go back in again and make a reassessment of this patient and see whether things have improved. You will repeat the CT scan and make sure whether things have got worsened or they have remained the same. Because everybody doesn't respond to chemotherapy. If there are certain histological variants, they will not respond.
And unless the bone is involved, on a CT scan, you can't make out infiltration or absence of infiltration into the pelvic walls because there's just a sliver of fat there. Right?
Yes.
So you have to do a EUA. So that would be the take-home message. Systematic, focused evaluation based on clinical presentation, early imaging, cytology, yes. At 70, you'd want to know. Even if you're doing it after ultrasound, it's worth doing for two reasons. One is to know whether we are already dealing with invasive or high-grade lesion. And second, possibility of concurrent upper tract lesions. 3, CT scan has to be tailored based on diagnosis. We can't have one fix for every situation, especially tumors like this. We will need to modify our CT scan technique and Kamal will tell us what modification has been done.
Yes, sir.
Examination under anesthesia is a must, both before starting the resection and at the end of resection. it has to be repeated if we're giving neoadjuvant chemotherapy before we take a decision on cystectomy. If cystectomy is done, the intent is palliative, and depending on histology, we may need to continue chemotherapy either for palliation or as an adjunctive chemotherapy. Right?
Yes, sir.
Right. Thank you.
We'll catch up next week, Prabhu. Maybe in the beginning, Kamal can 5 minutes he can take for the CT, and then we'll go on to the case.
Sure, sir.
Okay. Thank you all. Have a nice weekend. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
We'll meet next year.
Yes. Happy New Year.